Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for taking time out in joining the webinar today. As Akansha mentioned, my name is Ashwinder. I'm a senior engagement manager with Analysys Mason. I have about 10 plus years of strategy consulting experience, primarily focused on the telecoms, media, and digital sectors. Along with me is my colleague Ram Prasad, who's joined Analysys Mason about a couple of years back after doing his MBA from IIM Ahmedabad. He has also worked in the telecom, media, and digital sectors as well. Now, in terms of the agenda for today, what we wanted to discuss was basically the need as well as the business model of operator-led digital services or OTT services. And the way we are planning to structure this is that the first broad section that we want to discuss is to start off with the need for operators to offer digital services. Now, there could be two options for operators, either to continue focusing on their core revenues, or the other option could be to venture into the digital services arena and transform themselves into a digital enterprise. And the second section is then about if the operators do decide to offer digital services, then what are the potential business models that they can follow? Is it a walled garden approach wherein they build their own OTT services application but keep it only to their own users, or have their own application, OTT applications, but open to all of the consumers, having a carrier agnostic platform, or potentially offer follow partnership model wherein they don't build their own OTT application but just partner with an OTT provider to encash on the digital services opportunity. And then also what we want to touch upon is basically a couple of sample business model of operator-led video and messaging services based on our prior work of working with operators and developing business plans for them. So that's the brief agenda for today. Now, started with the first section, which is about the need for operator-led digital services. So essentially what is happening, and as most of you would be already familiar, so independent OTT providers are venturing into the arena, which was the staple or native to the traditional telecom operators. So essentially what they're doing is they're offering messaging services, voice services, video calling services, which was the forte of traditional telecom operators. And as you would see on the chart on the left top, OTT messaging has already overtaken SMSs globally in the year 2014 and 15. Similarly, on the voice side, what is happening is that OTT voice has a couple of niche use cases, primarily focusing on international voice calls as well as video calling. And as you would see on the chart on the bottom left, VoIP traffic now constitutes a significant proportion of the international voice traffic, constituting anywhere between more than 50% of the overall international voice traffic. There are a couple of drivers which is leading to the proliferation of OTT services, namely basically with the adoption of smartphone services. What is happening is that mobile broadband adoption has been increasing, also because of the fact that operators globally have been improving their 3G and 4G coverage. So because of that, what is happening is that OTT applications are seeing increasing adoption. For example, WhatsApp and Facebook Messenger already have more than 1 billion active users. Now, what this results is, if we see the chart on the right, as per an estimation done by TRAI, which is the regulator in India, traditional telecom operators are estimated to have lost anywhere between 20 to 25 billion US dollars of revenue in the year 2016 itself, which is approximately anywhere between 5 to 8% of the overall telecoms revenue in the year 2016. Thus, the threat of OTT is very real, and operators need to have plans in terms of how they want to counter this threat. Now, if we move on to the next slide, what this slide essentially shows is that in India specifically, what is happening is that OTT is again becoming omnipresent. So what you will see is that smartphone penetration has already reached about 30% penetration as of 2016. It's increasingly seeing adoption because of initiatives taken by operators. For example, the 1500 4G phone being launched in the market. So because of these initiatives, what is happening is that smartphone or 4G phone penetration is going to increase going forward. What is happening as a derivative of the increasing smartphone penetration, as well as the fact that mobile broadband tariffs have reduced. So from about 220 to 30 rupees of per GB tariffs, and about for about a year back to about 50 to 60 rupees per GB mobile broadband tariffs. So the tariff plus the smartphone penetration is leading to increasing mobile broadband uptake, and when I say mobile broadband, I mean 3G and 4G uptake. So at the end of 2016, there were about 217 million mobile broadband users, and because of the increasing mobile broadband adoption, services such as WhatsApp, Hike are seeing active user base of more than 100 million users in India itself. The graph on the right, what essentially shows us that because of the uptake of these OTT services, the trend has been that in terms of minutes of usage per user in India across different category circles, you can see that there is a clear trend that the minutes of usage has been decreasing, essentially because of cannibalization of the traditional legacy voice minutes by OTT minutes. And metro circles have been leading in this trend, and the other category circles have been following the trend. So essentially, as I mentioned earlier, the threat of OTT is very, very much omnipresent, even in a country like India, which is potentially a couple of years behind the more mature or developed telecoms markets. Now, in terms of options for the traditional mobile operators on how they can potentially counter this threat, so there could be two counters. One could be that the traditional mobile operators continue focusing on the core business, which essentially means that they continue focusing on voice, data, and SMS services, and try enhancing their services by and improving their financial metrics by either growing the subscriber base by increasing the market share, or probably getting a higher share of the new adds to the market. Or two, they could grow their ARPU by migrating customers to higher price plans, or migrating customers from non-mobile broadband users to mobile broadband users, and thus seeing an ARPU growth. And finally, what is happening is that IoT and connectivity of things is also leading to an additional traditional revenue pie for operators. But what operators in the developed markets have increasingly realized, and also operators in India as well are realizing, is that the opportunity available just in the core side is potentially limiting. So there is very limited growth potential available in the core business itself. So what operators globally are trying to do is to venture into other areas which are either extensions to the core, or potentially trying out new revenue opportunities. And what we are focusing on today is basically the extensions to the core. So these are the digital services. So these could be any of these services, like a TV video focused OTT service, or a financial service, or smart homes, which are being offered by operators globally as well as in India. And what this will do is that it not only provides the operator to monetize through direct revenues, but also increase their core revenues through indirect benefits. And this is something we are going to talk in detail in one of the following up sections. Now, of the two options which I mentioned, the first one being focusing on the core, what we suggest is that it's not advisable for operators to continue focusing on the core, because what is happening is that in an increasingly data world, and as data as a proportion of revenue increases for operators globally, what will happen is that the revenues and the EBITDA of operators are not going to increase in line with the growth in data revenue. And also what will happen is that as you could see on the chart, based on benchmarks from operators and markets which are probably a couple of years ahead of India in terms of telecoms maturity. So what is happening is that with increasing contribution of data as a proportion of their overall revenues, so the CAGR being about 17%, the revenue and EBITDA has only increased by low single digit numbers, whereas the capex intensity, or the capex as percent of revenue, has been increasing at more than 10-11%. Thus, what is happening is that if the operators continue focusing on the core, which is basically offering data, voice, and SMS services, then potentially they will have to, might not be able to grow as much as if they actually, you know, potentially venture into the digital service area. Now, having said that, operators globally have tried offering digital services, but the degree of success has been varying. One of the common themes which has come out from operators globally, which have been focusing on digital services, has been that although digital services has been seeing increasing uptake in terms of revenue growth, for example, Telefonica overall, you know, in the financial year 16 saw revenues going down. But in terms of digital services, they were able to see about a 14% growth in revenues. Thus, revenues has been, you know, revenue fall was countered to some extent by offering digital services. But most of these digital services have a long gestation period. So what happens is that even after 5 to 6 years of launch, operators like Singtel, Telefonica, and SK Telecom have not been able to convert their digital services business into a profitable or EBITDA positive business. Thus, there is a longer gestation period for these services, unlike you know, the core telecom business, which has high margins you know, from the start. Thus, any operator which is looking to offer you know, digital services needs to look at few you know, key considerations. The first one being that you know, given the scale of the core business, any digital service which is adding anywhere between 3 to 5% of revenues to the top line. Should be considered a success. Two, given the fact that you know, these new services are not high margin businesses, so the investment plans should be built in a way that it takes into account the fact that you know, the payback period would be longer for these digital services. Also, the third you know, thing which operators need to realize is that beyond you know, the direct revenue upside, there is also a indirect benefit that that they can see by offering you know, OTT services, which could increase their core business, reduce churn, and insulate their core business from the threat of independent OTT providers. So essentially, you know, summarizing the first half, you know, there are two options for operators to counter OTT threat. One being focusing on the core. It's not advisable for operators to continue focusing just on the core, because the revenue upside is limited. So operators need to focus on digital services. Although a few operators globally have tried offering you know, being focused on digital services, revenues have increased, but the EBITDA margin are still you know, have not been they've not converted their digital services business into a EBITDA positive. Now shifting towards you know, if an operator does decide to offer digital services, then we want to talk about what business models are available to operators to offer these digital services. So there are two key parameters on which an operator has to decide once they decide to offer a digital service. The first parameter being how to offer digital services. So should they build their own OTT application, or should they partner with an independent OTT provider, you know, getting a share of the revenue that the OTT provider gets. And if the operator does decide to build their own OTT application, then the next you know, decision parameter is to decide what are the target customers. Do they want to only you know, target their own customers and through a walled garden approach, or is it a carrier agnostic application which provide open access to all the mobile broadband users present in that country. Now, each of the approaches has its own pros and cons. So for example, you know, the first decision parameter on build your own versus partner with OTT provider. So essentially, the partner with OTT provider approach has the advantage that the time to market is much lesser, because you could, you know, partner with any OTT provider such as WhatsApp or Netflix and Amazon, and you know, the time to market would be much lower. Also, the investment required would be much lower. So essentially, you know, there is limited you know, risk on the mobile operator's end, because there is not much capex or opex investment on their part. However, the flip side is that you know, the operator only gets a small proportion of the overall revenue that the OTT provider gets, which is in the form of you know, carrier billing. So essentially, they get a share of the overall revenue coming to the independent OTT provider. And hence, we would say that, you know, the partner with OTT provider is not a long term you know, solution that an operator should potentially you know, look for. In fact, build your own is a more prevalent and you know, a more pragmatic approach of approaching digital services. Not effectively for all the digital services, but essentially for services like, you know, OTT music or video, it's a more pragmatic and, you know, a solution which offers revenue upside. And as I said, the pros of building your own application is that one, there is much larger revenue upside because of the fact that there is no revenue sharing happening with an independent OTT operator, but the entire you know, end user services is being provided by the operator itself. Now, within your build your own approach, as I mentioned, there are two approaches further. Whether you want to build a walled garden OTT service or you want to keep it carrier agnostic. Now, the difference is that in a walled garden approach, similar to an approach which Reliance Jio is following, you're only offering the service to your own users. So in that sense, the base users or the targeted users that you're addressing is only your own own mobile broadband users. So that's the potentially negative you know, side of walled garden approach. But the positive of this approach is that it helps the operator to differentiate its services from other operators, and hence it could see a market share upside because of the fact that it offers a differentiated OTT service. On the other hand, open access or carrier agnostic OTT services, what it does is that it offers a broad base of users which the operator can target. So essentially, the entire mobile broadband user base becomes the target market for the operator, and hence it's a you know, it's one of the approaches that we would suggest any you know, mobile operator which is venturing into OTT services should adopt, at least for, you know, high engagement OTT services like OTT video and music. Now, based on our prior work with operators, we wanted to share a sort of template or a framework in terms of how an operator should look at developing a business case for the OTT for different OTT service. Now, in terms of revenue items, there are two key revenue streams. One being the direct revenue stream, which comes from both the operator's own subscribers as well as the open market subscribers it caters to, you know, through an open or a carrier agnostic approach. So essentially, within direct revenues, there are multiple revenue streams, which being subscription revenue, ad revenue, in-app purchases, or, you know, other revenue streams such as SMS integration. But unlike an independent OTT operator, wherein there is no indirect revenue flowing to the player, for a mobile operator, there is you know, a substantial revenue upside which comes from indirect revenue sources. You know, which benefits the core business of the operator. So essentially, what happens is that because an operator is offering its own OTT service, it will see increased data users. Or essentially, what will happen is that some of the non-mobile broadband users of the operator could potentially migrate to mobile broadband users, and hence it could see some increase in ARPU because of the data uptake. Also, what will happen is that because the operator is offering a differentiated OTT service, it could also see a reduction in churn over a short to medium time frame. And third being that some of its current mobile broadband users could actually migrate to higher data plans because of the differentiated OTT service that the operator is offering. And hence, as I mentioned, an operator gets both a direct revenue upside as well as an indirect revenue upside from offering an OTT service. And an operator needs to take into consideration both the aspects when developing its own business case for an OTT service. On the cost side, there are two key you know, cost line items. One is the direct cost, which being, you know, content cost, distribution cost, or subscriber acquisition cost. And then there are the indirect costs, which is basically the cost of providing the data services, both the voice and data services. And yeah, essentially, you know, the revenue and the cost at a broad level give us the cash flows for the operators, and based on that, we calculate the break-even or the payback period for the operator for the modeled OTT service. Now, we would want to take you through a couple of examples in terms of frameworks of operator-led video and operator-led messaging service. Based on work we have done with operators in the past. So starting with an OTT video service, now as we discussed before, there are three approaches available to the operator in terms of how it wants to offer an OTT video service. We recommend that building its own OTT application, which is carrier agnostic, is the best approach, because OTT video is a high engagement emotional service in India. So video is a high emotion, or a high engagement service in India, and hence it is better for the operator to control the service if it has its own application. Also, if the operator has its own application, it can control a lot of the user experience that it offers. So it could offer the service in such a way that, for example, the quality of the application is such that it could run even on a 2G network. So essentially, it could monitor the network quality and tailor make its application to run even on a 2G network. The third factor is that the content licensing arrangements on video side are pretty complex, and there are cartels in terms of existing video content, and hence it is best if an OTT operator, a traditional operator, given scale, is able to handle all of the complexity in-house rather than relying on independent OTT provider. Because for the sake of continuity of the business and for continuity of the content licensing arrangements, it's better that all of the deals on the content side are made by the operator themselves. And finally, an own OTT service, especially for a high engagement service such as video, enables the operator to position itself as a digital company and a brand which is focusing on digital or OTT. And hence, there could be indirect benefits flowing to the operator over a longer period of time. Just quickly taking you through the overall OTT market size in India. So there are two broader revenue aspects within OTT video service. One is the subscription revenue, and the other is the ad revenue. And as of 2017, the OTT video subscription revenues were about 226 crores. Whereas the advertisement revenues were much higher, at about 1435 crores, and that is because users in India are not very adept at paying for OTT video services, or in fact any OTT service, and hence operators or OTT video providers have tried to monetize video through ad-driven revenue. Now, in terms of the framework, what we've done is that we have tried to build a P&L for an operator or a business case for an operator which is a hybrid or a hypothetical operator which has about 25% market share in an Indian market, to see what is the payback period for an OTT video service. And what the slide basically shows is that, as we discussed earlier, there are two sources of revenue. One is the direct revenue, other is the indirect revenue. What we have done here is that we've taken international benchmarks in terms of the adoption of OTT video services for an operator-led OTT services, and seen that how the uptakes varies over time. So essentially, within the subscription revenues, the first line item, which is video app active users, gives you the overall addressable base for the video application. And then based on global benchmarks, we say that there is going to be subscription revenue coming to the operator, and over time, based on global benchmarks, which suggests that globally the trend has been that an operator-led video services sees an adoption of paid adoption of anywhere between 20 to 25% adoption. We are being a little conservative on the market, and we are saying that even if there is about a 10% uptake of paid services, then you could see about 2.6 million paid users by the year 2022. And we are assuming a reasonable subscription charges of about 50 rupees, which is in line with what the OTT providers in India are offering. So essentially, the first revenue stream for the operator would be subscription revenue. We are suggesting heavily against not going to the advertisement route because you know, the user experience would be hampered if there are a lot of in-app ads or in video ads within the video service. In terms of indirect revenue, as we discussed in the framework slide, there are three key indirect revenue streams. One is the increase in the mobile broadband user base. So essentially, what will happen is that the operator should market its OTT video service as a free trial to its own user base. And based on benchmarks from Telefonica and a couple of operators globally, what we've seen is that the free trials result in about a 5% conversion factor over time. So what will happen is that because some of your current non-mobile broadband users are converting to mobile broadband, you will see an uptake in ARPU because of the increase in data ARPU of these users. The second indirect revenue stream is essentially a reduction in churn of the users which start using your OTT video application. And again, based on benchmarks, we forecast that this will result in anywhere between a 1 to 5% reduction in churn. We are again being conservative and assumed a 1% reduction in churn over time for the users who adopt the video service offered by the mobile operator. And finally, what will also happen is that for the current mobile broadband users of the operator, those users which convert or start using the OTT video application, they will see an uptake in terms of the amount of data that they're consuming. And hence, there will be an increased benefit to the core revenue of the operators through the increased data ARPU of the current mobile broadband users. And all of that will lead to a total revenue of 25 crores in the first year of launch of the service, which is 2018, which increases to about 430 crores by the year 2022. In terms of cost, there are three main costs here. One is the content acquisition cost, and based on benchmarks from Netflix, Amazon in India and globally, as well as based on benchmarks from Hotstar and so on, we know that the content acquisition costs are typically around 70% of the direct revenue of the operators, and hence we've built in the content acquisition cost as part of our P&L forecast. The second direct cost line item is the subscriber acquisition cost. And this is typically, based on our discussions with the OTT providers in India, the subscriber acquisition cost is typically around $1 per active user. The final cost is the distribution cost, which is around 25% of the direct revenues of the OTT application. And then there are the indirect costs, which is basically cost of providing the data or the voice service. And given that an operator typically has a EBITDA margin of anywhere between 30 to 35%, this is the EBITDA benchmark that we're using from mobile operators in India. So assuming a EBITDA margin of 35% on the indirect revenues, we forecast the indirect cost of the operator. And the top line on the chart on the left shows basically the total cost, including the direct and indirect cost for the OTT video application. This slide is basically a summary of the P&L for the operator. And what you will see is that the operator will become free cash flow positive by the year four. And on a payback period basis, an operator would see a payback time period of anywhere between 4 to 6 years, depending on how well they're able to execute some of their indirect revenue monetization and depends on the quality of content that the operator is able to offer on the video application. So that's about the P&L or the basic framework for an OTT video application. Now I would hand over to Ram to talk about a sample case of a IPL service being offered by a mobile operator.
Hi everyone, thanks Ashwin. So to continue with OTT video services, here we build a sample case of how IPL rights, the digital rights for the recently held IPL bid auction, could be captured by telecom operators. So despite them not actually winning the IPL digital rights, a high bid value of about $500 million still says a lot about how value accretive can OTT video be to operators' businesses. So in the left side of the slide, you see the total cost of ownership analysis. It's a bottom-up affordability analysis we've built for a sample marginal user who could afford OTT video services. So assuming that an entry-level 4G device of 3,000 rupees cost with decent specifications and a device replacement cycle of 2.5 years and subsequent data charges of about 60 rupees per GB and 5 GB data consumption, we say that the total subscription charges could be about 6,000 rupees per annum for OTT video user. And we, based on international benchmarks, typically users spend about 1.5% of their annual income on telecom services and equipment. And for a marginal user, it's around $6,000 per year, the income that they would be spending on telecom services. So in effect, what we're doing here is calculating the percentage of population who can afford OTT services based on their income distribution. So we see that about 12 to 16% of the population can afford OTT video service for IPL video over the next 6 years. So this number flows onto the right side of the slide, where we see that IPL market of currently 400 million users is expected to grow at a compounded growth rate of 10% over the next 6 years. So applying the percentage addressable population base over the entire reach of IPL, and applying the subscription rate top-up of only 15 to 25% over the next 6 years, we see that an operator could technically break even in the next 4 years and have a positive NPV of more than $30 million in the next 6 years within the time frame of the digital rights. These revenues are exclusive or excluding the ad revenues that could be potentially captured as part of the digital rights. So all this says is that operators being bullish on OTT content is actually a good thing for the industry, and Jio and Airtel have in turn bid very high amounts compared to the previous IPL digital right auctions. So in summary, we see that for the different kinds of customer segments that the operator could potentially target, what the operator could technically gain out of the OTT services. So in case the operator restricts its services only to its own customers, the revenues will be limited because the customer segment base is limited, but then the costs are also going to be lesser than in cases where they are open to everyone. And hence the net payback period could be about 2 to 4 periods with moderate returns. In case the OTT video service is open for everyone, in case it's more of an open platform that's been launched by the operators, the revenue upside is significantly high because they can in turn target the entire mobile broadband user base in the country. The costs would be higher than that in a walled garden customer approach. But then overall, if you look at the payback period, it's about 4 to 6 years, but on a much higher profit margin base. On the complete other side of the spectrum, if the operator simply acts as a dump pipe and simply partners with OTT providers, the revenue upside is limited, although this is a risk. A relatively risk-free investment, and hence the costs are also going to be significantly lower. The net payback period is lower, but the profits are also marginal compared to the other two cases. So in effect, as Ashwinder had mentioned earlier, the right strategy for an operator is to build the content for everyone without any discrimination to its users, although which could potentially result in a slightly higher payback period. So far, we've discussed one sample case of operators' hypothetical OTT video service. We'll now move on to another sample case where operator offers its own messaging service. Now, unlike OTT video service, OTT messaging service is slightly different in the sense that there's a big network effect associated with messaging services. So, for instance, messaging really starts kicking only when there are two users parallelly using the messaging app. This is not a common phenomenon you'll be observing in video services. Hence, we've also seen a lot of competition among the messaging service providers in the country. That being said, there is limited direct revenue uptake that operators could witness as a result of messaging. The point being, apart from advertising, operators or messaging service providers haven't been really able to create source of revenue. E-commerce is still a nascent form of obtaining revenues for operators and could only be a source of revenues in a span of 2 to 4 years after the launch of the application. Indirect revenues are also limited for OTT messaging apps compared to OTT video services because there are no such indirect benefits such as churn reduction or a significant increase in market share that operators could gain out of launching a messaging service. That being said, we strongly believe that messaging service is something that an operator should offer as a hygiene factor so as to act as a custodian for its own set of customers rather than as a significantly highly value accretive business prospect. In the next slide, we see very directional numbers for operator-led OTT messaging services. Assuming that the operator launches its OTT services in the next year, they could get about 100 million or more active subscribers in the 5 years after the launch. This is further substantiated by the trends from other messaging services such as WhatsApp and Hike, registering more than 100 million in nearly 6 to 7 years after they have been actually launched in the country. And the point is that messaging apps are not as heavy as video apps, and people usually have multiple messaging platforms on their mobile phones. Hence, there is a room for OTT, for an operator launching an OTT messaging service in the country. So despite there being a high competitive intensity in the country, the fact that an operator could potentially act as a custodian for its own customers implies that messaging could act as a potential OTT service that the operator could venture into. So in the next slide, we again build a sample case for operator launched OTT messaging service in the country. Now, the stark contrast you'll experience here is that the model is built for 8 years after launch instead of only 4 to 6 years for an OTT video service. And another distinction from the video service business case is that there are limited indirect revenues we are categorizing right now at the moment. And in terms of subscription revenues, the primary source of revenue would be advertisement revenues from the year of launch. And within a couple of years after launch, once the platform really hits a big scale, e-commerce transactions could be sorted through the portal or the mobile application. So in case the mobile application really kicks in scale, the e-commerce transactions could potentially contribute to a significant chunk of revenues after the 7th or 8th year after launch. These numbers are again based on some of our prior work and from some of the international benchmarks that we've collected as part of our prior experience. Another point to note is that although we are not categorizing a lot of indirect revenues at the moment, we are being slightly conservative here, but an operator could potentially derive revenues out of customer analytics platforms in the future once the app really starts achieving a bigger scale. In terms of costs, we see that content acquisition costs for a messaging platform are relatively lesser compared to that of a video platform. And subscriber acquisition costs relatively remain similar to that of a video service as well. And distribution costs are only kicked into effect once the platform starts selling e-commerce services. And indirect costs, for the moment, we are assuming to be zero on the OTT service. As a summary of the P&L statement, we notice that the free cash flows really become positive only after 6th year of the messaging platform's launch. And the payback period is about 8 to 9 years of launching the messaging service. That being said, despite there being a very high payback period compared to video services, we believe that operators should launch OTT messaging services because they could really safeguard their customers from being poached by competitors in the market space. To summarize, the extent to which operators could choose between building the messaging app for their own customers versus simply acting as a dumb pipe and being an intermediary between a notification provider and its customers. Again, we see that revenues are moderate in case the operator builds it for its own customers, but then the advantages of lower costs are present, but then the payback period could still be about 8 to 10 years with limited revenue upside. In case the operator actually builds the platform for open access, and because of the fact that messaging has network effect into its game, we see that revenue upside is significantly higher and the costs are slightly higher than that of building a platform for its own customers. But then the payback period relatively remains similar to about 8 to 10 years, but with higher margins to be revealed. In case the operator remains a dumb pipe, the revenues are limited and again the costs are limited. So in effect, it's not a very profitable business for the operator to venture into. So to summarize the entire strategy that operators need to undertake pertaining to digital services, we have identified four critical success factors in this slide. The first of which is that operators need to create a suite of digital services rather than simply picking one or two digital services and focusing on them. That would result in building a sort of ecosystem for its customers and also help in reducing churn and in turn increasing the market share for the operator. The second of which is that operators need to build their platform more as an open platform business rather than themselves and building it on a standalone basis. We have seen this being achieved with decent success in markets like the US and Germany, where AT&T and Deutsche Telekom have implemented it. The third is that operator needs to build a value proposition rather than simply providing these services. We've actually seen this being into effect after the entry of Reliance Jio in the country. Operators have been very proactive in terms of launching bundled services rather than discrete services in the country. And that really ensures that operators retain their chunk of customer base in increased competition. The fourth is that operators should achieve parity in terms of launching the OTT service with that of a standalone OTT player, because user experience is one of the critical aspects of OTT video or messaging or even music services. And hence, the user experience with that of a mobile app or that of a web-based service should be significantly comparable to that of an independent player in the industry. This is the summary of the findings that we discussed over the last 30 to 40 minutes in this session. We'll be happy to take any questions if there are any.
The first question is, what percentage of revenue can an operator's own OTT apps contribute?
Okay, so based on benchmarks from operators in the more developed markets such as Korea, US, or even Germany, or the European markets, what we have seen is that the contribution of digital services in a very mature or a focused digital services operator could be anywhere between 5 to 10% as of now. What needs to be realized is that operators in the more mature markets are seeing declining overall or rather revenue from the core business because these markets are not seeing any growth in the overall market and ARPUs are declining. And hence, what digital services, even if they're contributing anywhere between 5 to 10%, what this is doing is at least stemming the decline of the overall core revenue of the operators. Summarize, basically anywhere between 5 to 10% revenues coming from OTT services is what the operators could expect in the short to medium time frame. Over the longer time frame, obviously these numbers would increase to much higher percentage.
Next question: for analytics on subscribers, would the privacy policy not come in the picture? How does the telco monetize subscribers' data in case there is guideline on PP introduced that is similar to the one in Germany or Malaysia?
So again, yeah, just to so every regulator or every country has its own policy in terms of how you could monetize the data that's that's collected from the users. Now, yeah, agreed, there are challenges in terms of how you could monetize. Will the operator be allowed to use customer analytics to upsell to its own users, or could they offer the data to third party providers? Obviously, this varies from market to market, and agreed. I mean, in India, for example, there is no clear regulation in terms of how the operators could leverage the data and user insights to monetize this. But I think what will happen is that as this increasingly starts to happen, for example, what is happening is Telstra, for example, it uses its own customers' data to see how the cohort is behaving, just to see what consumers are are using location-based services. For example, if they know that a consumer is in a mall, they would send very targeted ads or very relevant content to the user. So there are markets wherein this is already happening. Regulation is very, very different from market to market. And in fact, I think this is too nascent a service at the moment to have a universal guideline in terms of how regulators will approach this service line. It's remains to be seen what TRAI sees in terms of how the operators could leverage data analytics.
Next question. Theoretically, video service model looks very good, but how do you expect a new operator to compete when there are already so many core content players like Amazon, Netflix, Hotstar, etc., competing in this space?
See, I think video is a high engagement service, and what essentially happens is that if you have the right content on your platform, it does not matter when you launch the service, you would be able to compete well. But what an operator has to realize, or any OTT player which is offering a video service has to realize, that if the content is differentiated, you would be able to see traction, irrespective of the fact when your service was launched. That does not matter. For example, Hotstar launched only around 2014-15 time frame. But given the fact that they had the IPL rights, they were able to get about 130 million active users on its platform during key IPL events. And if an operator, led OTT service is able to have some sort of unique or differentiated content, let's say it's some sort of cricket content or some sort of internally developed content. So for example, Netflix and Amazon have their own proprietary content. So if an operator-led service is able to venture into differentiated content, I don't think gaining traction would be a challenge.
Next question. You mentioned advertising as one of the new opportunities. Could you please elaborate on how can this be a standalone diversification strategy?
So advertisement, probably I would need to clarify, but so when we say about advertisement, there was this a part of the advertisement opportunity comes from the advertisement revenue which is a part of the OTT video application. So basically, there could be ads which could be in video, advertisement which could be pre-roll, mid-roll, or post-roll ads. As you would see in any application like YouTube, so there are ads which are pre-roll, mid-roll, and post-roll. So what essentially happens is that given the fact that YouTube has about 50 to 60 million users in India, advertisers have realized the power of OTT video, and hence they are increasingly focusing on digital as a platform for targeted as advertisements. So, for example, YouTube has the capability wherein it could modify the ad based on the demographic profile of the user, so based on the location of the user, whether it's metro versus non-metro, what sort of content you know, the user has been viewing in the past. So it uses all of those demographic and other behavioral you know, aspects of the user to have very targeted ads. And these are typically cost per impression or cost per click sort of models on which you know, this ad-driven model works. And hence, as I said, YouTube almost gets about more than $120 million only in India from the ad monetization model. Most of the other OTT players in India, you know, are currently using a freemium model, which is basically that the low non-differentiated content or the mass content is offered on a non-subscription model, but monetized basically through ads, and the premium content is typically monetized through subscription. And yeah, it's an increasingly adopted model by OTT video platforms.
Next question. There is already a sea of messaging apps. How is there still scope for new OTT messaging apps?
So if you look at the slide, so I agree with the fact that there's a lot of competition in the industry in terms of the messaging apps. There's already WhatsApp and Haiku have a significantly high chunk of user base. But like you said, users have shown propensity to install multiple apps on their phone. And in case they like certain features of the apps, such as stickers or GIFs, you could witness that these are adopted by certain demographics in the country. For example, younger population might be very enthusiastic about installing apps which feature stickers and GIFs. This has been seen in the case of KakaoTalk in South Korea, which has gained a lot of prominence in that country. So while we do agree with the fact that there is a high competition in the industry, but then sufficient diversification or sufficient differentiation of services could see that the operator has enough installs.
Next question. Is it relevant for fixed lines operators to explore OTT?
Is the question that is there any chance for fixed line players to enter into OTT? Is that what the question is?
Yes, this is the question.
Okay, so what is happening is that you know, globally fixed broadband players have entered into OTT. Essentially, it's not fixed broadband players, but what has happened globally is that most of the mobile operators are converged operators, wherein they have a mobile and a fixed line business, and they've ventured into OTT as well. And obviously, there are cases in the US where Comcast, for example, has its own OTT application as well. But if we talk about India specifically, as of now, given that, you know, the scale of most of the independent fixed broadband players is so low, so if we bar MTN and BSNL and Airtel and you know, which are the largest two fixed broadband players in India, the scale of these fixed broadband players is so low, which is essentially, you know, less than 1 million fixed broadband you know, connections, that it's difficult to build a, you know, reasonable business case of offering a differentiated you know, OTT application. However, what has happened is that fixed broadband players are, there are examples when fixed broadband players have partnered with OTT players. For example, ACT, which is a player which is focused on the southern markets, you know, started from Hyderabad, has about 1.2 million fixed broadband users, one of the largest independent fixed broadband users in India, partnered with an independent OTT provider called YupTV, wherein you know, and YupTV is a South Asian content focused OTT video application, wherein the ACT's users had the option of bundling the fixed broadband connection with the YupTV application. So basically, what happened was, if you're buying a ACT you know, service, you would get a bundled YupTV you know, subscription as well. So there are not a lot of examples, especially in India, wherein fixed broadband providers are launching their own OTT application. But yeah, there are examples wherein fixed broadband players are partnering with OTT players, and this will be increasingly more common going forward.
Taking our last question, do you think the core telco players will be able to compete with the Silicon Valley tech giants in innovating in the digital space and develop their own niche?
Yeah, that's a very valid and good question. And yeah, but I mean, operators globally, even in the mature markets like US, Europe, developed Asia Pacific, have been trying to compete against the digital, the independent OTT providers. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the degree of success they've seen has been varying. So what has been the common theme across the digital services initiatives by mobile operators in the more mature markets? Clearly, what is happening is that, as I mentioned, operators have been able to at least compete decently with the independent OTT applications by having some sort of differentiation against the independent OTT providers. It could be in terms of differentiated content, it could be in terms of differentiated services or features that they could offer on their application. For example, HD calling, or if it's an OTT video application, it could be customizing their application to run on 2G networks and so on. And hence, the revenue potential, or they've been able to decently compete. But having said that, independent OTT providers are more agile. And even though mobile operators have tried to spin off their own digital services verticals, the degree of success has not been comparable to OTT independent OTT providers, potentially because of the mindset that operators have had. But what you'll see going forward is that if operators have to defend their turf and not just rely on the core revenues, they will at some point in time realize that it's not possible just to focus on the core business, and they will have to venture and participate in the OTT opportunity.